Hi guys, welcome back to yet another episode. I'm Advocate Khosan Irani and today we're going to discuss about the police. The history of police goes back to the Vedic ages and even prior to that to the Mahabharata and the Ramayana periods. They have been recorded in these pieces of literature as traffic polices. They've been recorded as authorities in charge of ensuring the crime is prevented, and policing has gone on to through the Hindu rule to the Mughal rule, and authorities like tehsildars, zamindars, and other authorities, sipais, all of them were created during these periods. However, it's noteworthy that during these periods the corruption rate was skyrocketing, and any person with influence and power was able to buy out this police force and get his will done. What majorly changed is during the period of the East India Company. Now, the East India Company came into India around 1612, in the year 1612. When the East India Company came into India, they came in with the intention to trade with the rulers, the then rulers, and their intention of trade later on fructified into intention to rule, and this happened during the Battle of Plassey, where the British Empire managed to, the East India Company managed to overthrow the Indian rulers, and these, when this took place, the East India Company gained a large control on India, and in 1700, in the year 1706 to the year 1770, I believe that 772 specifically, Warren Hastings, the first Governor General of India, made it his mission to start expanding this army, and when he started expanding this army, he started importing inter-caste soldiers in the same force. What basically this did is a person of a inferior caste was made to dine with a person of a superior caste. This offended the person with the superior caste, and these drifts started in the year 1806, started to create a divide between Hindus and Muslims, because even Hindus and Muslims were working together in the same force, which started creating a little drift, and this drift became serious in the year 1857 when the rebellion took place, which was due to the lacing of the cartridges with fat of pigs and cows, these cartridges of rifles which were laced with these fats, and this was the peak, pivoting point. This was when the revolt kicked in, and the person who started the revolt was Mangal Pandey, an officer, and he disobeyed the superior's command. In fact, he took out his revolver and he shot the superior and killed him, and after that with his rifle, he even had a battle with other few commanding officers. And not only this, what was the most essential part was that another superior officer demanded his inferior officers to arrest Mangal Pandey, but all of them being Indian decided to not follow the command, and this created the rebel. And not only this, after Mangal Pandey was executed, he was hung to death, and so were the officers who had refused to follow the order of the superior officer. After this, the rebel kicked in, and the East India Company almost lost control of the country. Therefore, after 1857, the need for regulating and controlling the police force became very serious, and the first Police Act of 1861 had been passed by the Parliament. Now, this act introduced an Inspector General who was at the provincial level the head of the province. It is to be noted that during the British rule, states were referred to as provinces, and later on when India declared itself independent, we referred to them as states. So the provinces were under the control of the Inspector General. The police of the province was under the control of the police Inspector General, and each district of this province had a superintendent of police. So these superintendents reported to the Inspector General, and the juniors of the superintendent reported to the superintendent. Now, initially, the method of entering into the police force was through nominations or by being part of the British Army or being a relative of someone who was in the British Army. This continued up till 1893 when the law changed and a procedure of competitive exams was started. Again, these competitive exams back in 1893 were only the people who were allowed to give these competitive exams were only Britishers and not Indians. And later on in 1902, the police commission permitted Indians to also start applying and taking posts. But the police force did not allow for the police who were being imported into the force were not regarded as imperial police, and they were not allowed to take the imperial police post. Now, the imperial police post is the higher rank post, and later on in 1948, the imperial police has been renamed to the Indian Police Services, which we all know is the All India Service, which is given to which allows for the higher ranking officers to be elected. There were two noteworthy commissions which basically recommended that the Indian force, the police force, comprise of larger number of Indians and Indian interaction starts increasing. However, these commissions were never really enforced because of the world wars, and they were just left silently. Now we have a look at the different types of ranking system, and as we discussed earlier, this hierarchy decides the powers. So the most amount of power vests with the Director General of Police, who is the head of the police force of the state. Then it goes on below Additional Director General, Inspector General of Police, then the Deputy Inspector General of Police, then Senior Superintendent of Police, and so on and so on. And so Senior Superintendent of Police was the district in charge. And going to the lower head constable, and last is the constable. So a high ranking officer has all the powers that the lower officers have, but a lower ranking officer does not have all the powers of the higher ranking officer. Moving on, police is a state subject. Therefore, each state has its own laws regulating police forces. However, there is a central police force as well. The central police force is so as to aid the state. When the state police is declared as incompetent or that they cannot prevent internal disturbances, then the central police force can step in and take charge and protect the state. This central police force was used once during the emergency declared by Indira Gandhi. Moving on, the police manual for the purpose of this lecture is a little bit on the side of the Maharashtra police manual. Police manuals are basically the manuals that contain the entire history, geography of appointment, retirement, promotion, establishments, qualifications, transfers, all the details required to understand how the police force is to function, and how establishments are to be created, and everything is contained within the police manual. This manual, the Bombay Police Manual, runs into thousands of pages. So you can imagine the exhaustive information found in that manual. Now, this manual talks about almost all circumstances and scenarios. It talks about stray dogs. In case stray dogs are found by police officers, then they have to make a report. They have to make a report about rabies, about people who have fear of water, because that is a sign of rabies. So they have to make an entire list of information about these things. They have to make a list, traffic police, how they will behave. Qualification, the chest size of the different ranking officers, which is the minimum requirement, and the age brackets of these officers that is required, the physical strength of these officers. So each attire of police officers has their own requirements and their own standards. It is noteworthy that the standards for constables and head constables is very, very low, the threshold. It is disappointing because we need our police force to be more educated so that they do not abuse or do not be misinformed or do not... They are ignorant about the law. So if they are ignorant about the law, they cannot enforce it properly. This also discusses the duties of each of these ranks of police officers, the duties of the police in general, and it also discusses the magistrate. The magistrate in the olden days and as of today is in charge of the police force of the state, and the magistrate plays a very unique role. Now, in India, we have adopted a doctrine of separation of powers under our constitution. This doctrine of separation of powers means that the executive organ, which is the police, and the judiciary, which is the magistrate, are supposed to be independent and work separately. The executive is to make sure that the law is being executed and is being followed, and the judiciary is to make sure that the law is being followed in the correct manner. They are supposed to read and interpret the law, and they are supposed to make sure that it's followed in the correct manner, and the executive is to make sure that it's being followed. So the judiciary cannot superimpose itself on the executive. It cannot dictate terms of how to appoint, where to appoint, when to appoint. It cannot decide these things. These things have to be done by the government, the executive wing. And when, but at the same time, the magistrate, criminal or civil courts, both have been vested with the inherent power to prevent miscarriage of justice. Therefore, that inherent power is a trump card, where the magistrate can just evoke that power to make sure that nothing is going wrong or grossly wrong. Moving on, there are two types of arrests. First of all, what is an arrest? Arrest is the suspension of the liberties of a person. Every person has the right to move freely and to do whatever he pleases within permissible limits of law. When these rights are taken away, the person is said to have been arrested. Now, when the person is arrested, a person is actually a suspect. He's not accused of anything. He is suspected of committing some offence, and when he is suspected of committing an offence, the offence is defined under the Indian Penal Code, generally defined under the Indian Penal Code and the Criminal Procedural Code. Now, the definition of the offence comes from the Indian Penal Code generally, and the punishment prescribed comes under the Indian Penal Code, but whether it is a what kind of offence it is, the gravity of the offence is determined under the Criminal Procedural Code, where the first schedule of the Criminal Procedural Code. So the first schedule says that if a person commits theft, the theft, it is going to be a certain type of offence. It's either going to be bailable, non-bailable, cognizable, non-cognizable, compoundable, non-compoundable. Now what are these things? What are these different types? A bailable offence is where it's a matter of right. Bail is a matter of right. What is a bail? A bail is basically the liberty of a person is restored under certain conditions, if certain conditions are met by that person. So a bail, the restoration of your liberty is a right that you have if the offence is bailable. If the offence is non-bailable, you still have the right to bail. However, you have to get that from the magistrate. In a bailable offence, you can get your bail from the police who's arresting you. So as soon as he comes to arrest you, you tell him, what's my bail? What is it set at and what are the conditions? He'll give you the list of conditions. You sign a document, give him the money, whatever the money is officially demanded, and to secure your bail, and you're free to go. However, in a non-bailable case, the police arrests you, they take you to the jail. After taking you to the police station, they keep you under detention, and after keeping you under detention, they produce you before the magistrate, where you can make your case for anticipatory bail, and you can get bail over there. If the circumstances and the case permit for a bail to be granted, what, for example, in case you have been suspected of committing murder, and the reason you have been suspected is because the police saw you stab the man with the knife, the police tried to save the man died, you had the knife in your hand, you didn't seem to have committed that offence under any exception, it was cold-blooded murder, and the police has proper knowledge of this, and the police has reported his findings to the magistrate. Now the magistrate is not inclined to grant you bail because the magistrate knows you cold-heartedly did this and you thought carefully and you did this. Therefore, from circumstance to circumstance, the magistrate decides whether bail should be granted or not. However, it's always a thumb rule of followed by the judiciary that bail be granted, because we follow a principle: innocent until proven guilty. So if you're innocent until proven guilty, why should your rights be suspended? Moving on, cognizable and non-cognizable offences. Cognizable offences are offences where a warrant is not required in order for the police to arrest you. What is a warrant? A warrant is basically when the magistrate issues an order in which he mentions that a person is being charged with a certain offence and needs to be arrested so that he cannot evade the law. Now again, going back a little back, why is arrest done? A person is arrested so that he does not abuse or frustrate the process of law. He does not tamper with evidence. He does not run away. He does not go into hiding. He does not do anything so that he cannot be punished for what he has done. So therefore, the police wants to secure your presence so that you cannot evade the law. That is why a person is arrested. Now, a person may also be arrested to aid the police in investigation. So if the police wants to ask you, interrogate you and ask you questions about the offense and other things, the police is free to do so by arresting you. Now, however, they have to follow the due process of law. Now, when you're being arrested, you have certain rights. The first right is to know who's arresting you, whether he's genuinely a police officer. So therefore, you can ask the person arresting you, what is his capacity, under what law he's arresting you, what is his identification. So generally, you do not need to follow, just because he's wearing a uniform does not mean he's a police officer. It could be a case of misrepresentation. It could be a case that the person is lying. Therefore, you have the right to confirm he's a police officer. How can you confirm he's a police officer? You can call up 100, the police control station, and you can check with their database whether this person is registered as an inspector, and if so, or whether he's a constable, and if so, what is his badge number? You can get it from 100. You can cross-check it, his badge number, his belt number. There's a unique number assigned to each officer. That unique number is on his belt, usually printed on his belt. So you can ask him for that number. You can cross check it with the police on their easy to reach number 100. And you can also check his badge. He's supposed to be carrying his identification on his person when he's performing a procedure of arrest. So if he's not in his uniform, if he's not in with his identification, you need to demand for it so that you can get to know whether he's truly a person or whether your life is in danger, because it could be somebody has set him up and sent him to take you under the pretext of being arrested, and then you get landed up getting killed. So you don't want to take that risk. You want to confirm he's a police officer. Now the minute he's done that, his duty is to inform you whether the offense is bailable or non-bailable. If it's bailable, you have the right to ask the bail right there and then and give pay of the bail and get out. Now the next thing after identifying this person, remember, if he's not willing to share his identity, you don't have to submit to him. You do not have to follow him. And if he tries to forcefully arrest you, you can also resist under the right to private defense. And you can apply reasonable amount of force, equal to the amount of force he's applying. So if he gives you a slap, you are entitled to give him a slap to ensure that he does not arrest you. If he punches you, you're allowed to punch him, but you must make sure that you are applying the force equal to the force he's applying. You cannot exceed the force he's applying. If he pushes you and you take a bat and beat the living daylights out of him, that's not permissible. But if you do something to just make sure that he's not harming you, that's permissible. Now moving on, the first thing the police is supposed to do is make a memorandum, a written understanding of what has transpired at the time of the arrest. He's supposed to write down where he's arresting you, why he's arresting you, the time, the date, and he's supposed to get two witnesses to sign, countersign the document saying they have witnessed that the arrest has taken place in this form, you have been informed of your rights, other things, they countersign. So This memo of arrest is supposed to be furnished to you after the memo is prepared. After this, the police is supposed to permit you to call up your relative, friend, or any person you desire and inform them about your arrest and where you're being taken after the arrest, the reason for your arrest. During this time, it is advised that you inform them that you have not been injured as of yet. You are totally fine, you're okay, this, and that you would like to talk to them in private when you meet them. Moving on, you have the right to make a note of the bodily injuries already on your body and take a countersign from the police officer that you have informed him that there are no bodily injuries on your body as of yet and you are in a perfectly okay condition. This document, you can either take a photograph of it and send it to your relative or you can keep it with you safely. Moving on from here, you have also the right to get medically examined if you so desire. You inform the police officer that I want a medical examination and a doctor will be provided. The doctor will charge his fees and he will examine you thoroughly and make sure a report is created stating the time of the report and the amount of injuries and bodily marks on your body at the time of the report. This is essential because as we know that sometimes the police unknowingly or mistakenly assaults the arrested person and causes bodily injury. So it is wrong for them to do so. Therefore, you need to keep a record of all this. Moving on, it is the duty of the police officer to present you within 24 hours before the magistrate. Now, when a police arrests you, initially you are under police custody. Police custody means you are under the care of the police. You are the responsibility of the police. Your health and well-being is the responsibility of the police. After, in this 24 hours, the police cannot keep you under their custody for all their life. They need to, within 24 hours, take you before the magistrate. They produce you before the magistrate, who is the judiciary, who is another independent body, and he decides whether you should be returned back to the police, if there's good ground for you to be kept under arrest, or whether you should be given a bail and you should be released. Now, when the magistrate is looking at the case, he again looks into the case circumstances and he determines what should be done. And when you have been presented to the magistrate, now you are under judicial custody. What is judicial custody means now the magistrate is responsible for your safekeeping. Therefore, now the responsibility being on him, he usually passes an order that you be presented before him every now and then, which is also referred to as a remand. So you come before the the magistrate and then you are again told to go back to the police. So this is a remand process. You are remanded back and every time, this remand period, there's a period. Every so many days, you're supposed to be brought before the police, before the magistrate. Magistrate determines whether you require to stay with the police and sends you back. He also checks, inquires into your health and well-being. After this, we move on to the next aspect, which is you have the right to have your lawyer present when you are being interrogated. Whenever the police is coming and asking you questions, you have the right not to speak a word and to demand that your lawyer be present. Now, not always this demand might be given into. There are certain circumstances where the police might find that if you have a lawyer, you might evade speaking the truth or you might evade certain things. So, in those circumstances, the police might take permission from the magistrate and deny you the right to your lawyer. Moving on, the information about your arrest, supposing you are the information about your arrest needs to be placed in a conspicuous place of the police station. The reason behind this is, in case a loved one or a friend or the person you inform about your arrest or tried to inform or could not inform is interested in knowing where you are, they can go to the police station and this information should be on visible on a certain place which is easily accessible to the public and which is popping out there. It should not be hidden away. If it is hidden under his drawer or under his table, you're never going to find it. That defeats the purpose. Therefore, the list of all the people arrested, the time at which they were arrested, needs to be maintained and kept in such a place where any person who walks into the police station will be able to access and get the information out. Finally, rights regarding search. If a police officer ever tries to search your person, you have the right before, in addition to the above rights, you have a right to search that person's, that police officer's body, and he needs to oblige to your request. So if he is coming to search you, in order to prevent him from planting any evidence onto you, you can search him and check if he's got evidence. If he's got evidence, you can refuse the search and tell him, I will not succumb to the search because you already have this on you. Therefore, you have a right to search him, and following that, you can be searched. You have also, it is the duty of the police to create a panchnama. A panchnama, generally the word panchnama means panch is five people, five head, and nama is a report or a statement. So panchnama is a statement of five heads. Now this statement basically is supposed to be done by two people in this case, in the case of police reports and police panchnamas. Minimum two people need to give their statement of what happened, what transpired, when the search was going on, what transpired, when the arrest was going on, what transpired. They need to make a statement at that point of time. This statement becomes a part of your case, your trial, and becomes a part of your defense. It allows you to create your defense. All these documents require to be provided to you so that you can establish your defense and best defend yourself. Finally, the rights under the Constitution. The Constitution of India is our supreme legislation as such. It is a living embodiment of our rights. It is the people, what the people have given the people, and it is where we source all our law from. So under part 3 of the Constitution, which contains the fundamental rights, every citizen has a right to equal protection of law and equality before law. What this means is laws are going to be equally applicable to all, regardless of gender, religion, sex, and regardless of these factors. They are non-biased. They apply to all equally. And everybody is entitled to the same procedure. Nobody is special and can ask for a special procedure. Everybody is entitled to a same procedure, unless reasonable restrictions are made by the government, and these reasonable restrictions of course are upheld and kept as constitutionally valid. The next aspect is also equal protection of law includes that you are protected by Article 141, which is law declared by the Supreme Court. So any law declared by the Supreme Court should be applicable to your case and circumstances, should it match those guidelines and the order of the Supreme Court. The next thing is Article 20, which is one of the most important jurisprudential aspects of the Constitution as far as criminal law is concerned. No person, the first sub-article is that no person can be convicted of an offence which was not an offence at the time of commission. What that means is, supposing today in India, murder is not an offence. Supposing it's not an offence today. In that case, if I committed murder and tomorrow murder becomes an offence, and what I did yesterday, the act that I did, taking a knife and stabbing it into somebody else cold-heartedly because I want that person to end his life, want to end that person's life, then, and that is exactly the definition of murder, tomorrow. And tomorrow, not only that, it is also punishable. I am also subject to a penalty or sanction. Then in such a case, I cannot be tried for the murder that I did yesterday. Because yesterday when I did it, there was no law on it. Therefore, ipso facto law is the first article of first sub-article of Article 20. Second sub-article is double jeopardy. Double jeopardy is no person can be convicted for the same offense twice. Supposing I was caught committing murder and I was taken to the court and the magistrate, the judge basically decides that yes, he has committed murder, and I give him 14 years or life imprisonment, and after life imprisonment I appeal it, and the procedure, High Court says no, for the punishment is correct. I go to Supreme Court, Supreme Court says no, punishment is correct. Then after that, if the police again initiates a proceeding saying, oh, he committed murder, and again starts the proceeding that I committed murder, it cannot work. That murder, it can be punished one time. After that, I cannot be punished again for the same murder. That is contained in Article 20, Sub-Article 2. Article 20, Sub-Article 3 is the right to remain silent. You have the right to refuse to give information that might implicate you in the offense. So you have the right to not say a word and to just sit quietly so that you do not give evidence to the police and get yourself into trouble by making a statement. So you have the right to remain silent. This is something I would recommend that all citizens exercise the right under Article 20, that you do not need to inform the police anything. If you have committed an offense, you don't have to say anything. He asks for ID, you show him ID. That's about it. If he asks for ID and you do not have a valid ID, you can exercise this right or Article 20. Tell him I reserve my right under Article 20. I do not want to say anything. I want my lawyer. Let my lawyer come and determine whether I should show you ID, what ID should I show you. And you exercise that right. You have the right to life and liberty. Now, because of this right, we have the right to bail. Bail is a sub-facet of Article 21, which is life and liberty. Life and liberty permits that everybody has a right to live happily, to live a reputable life, to live a free life. Article 21 plays a crucial role because it is Article 21 that decides that you have to be produced before the magistrate within 24 hours of your arrest. This is so that you are not... right to life is a sacred right. We get to live once. Every minute you spend, you should spend it enjoying your life. And if you are arrested and put up in lockup and you're not permitted to enjoy your life or do something you want to do, that would be encroaching upon the right to live, which is a right given eternally by whatever superpower. So therefore, the right to live becomes very crucial, and the Constitution protects that right. And that is why we hold that every person is innocent until proven guilty. Moving on, you have a right to constitutional remedy. Supposing any of your fundamental rights are breached by the government, then you have the right to knock on the doors of the High Court or the doors of the Supreme Court under Article 226 and 32 respectively, and demand that you be that cognizance be taken of the encroachment by the government, and you be protected. One essential writ, these Article 32 and Article 226 are what we refer to as writs, writ petitions. These writs can be enforced at any point of time, and when enforced, one of the most essential ones is writ of habeas corpus. Habeas corpus is when the police arrests you without following the process of law, or when the police is not willing to allow you to meet your family, or they're not willing to show your family whether you're okay or not. You can demand that the court compels the police to bring the arrested person before the court, just so that the court can satisfy itself that nothing wrong has happened, nothing wrong has been committed by the police. Moving on, the police force in India is not perfect, and it is far from perfect, and they can't discharge their duties on their own. They require the functions of the citizens. They require the help of the citizens. And for this purpose, the citizens under Article 51A have been given the responsibility to do to report offences, certain offences which the state believes are very critical and very important to be informed to the police. Therefore, these offences, this duty, first of all, this duty is not an obligation. A citizen, if he does not follow these duties, it does not mean that he can be compelled to follow these duties. These duties are part of the directive principles and policies. So these are just directives, they are directions, they are general guidelines what the government expects from a citizen. It expects that a citizen will inform the state about these offenses. So again, it's not binding, a citizen need not do it. But it is what the state expects and would prefer that a citizen does, so that the state can help serve the people better. It's not with any ill motive or agenda. Many people feel that the police force is evil and you're not supposed to go to them. But to some extent, if you want a safer environment, you have only one option, go to the police, report the offense so that the police can take charge and they can help you out. Among other things, there are certain landmark judgments which all of you guys need to read, which we won't be getting into in detail here. However, citations have been given, and a little bit I might talk about one or two. For example, the DK Basu case, which is a landmark judgment of the Supreme Court, which means if any of these judgments, the findings and the orders, the ratio decidendi of these judgments, if it's not followed, ratio decidendi meaning the enforceable part of this judgment, if it's not followed by the authorities, then they would be in contempt of court, and appropriate proceedings can be initiated against them, and they would be in violation of the law as declared under Article 141. Now, the DK Basu case is a landmark judgment wherein guidelines were set out, what all the duties of the police are, those were set out, which we have discussed a little earlier, those are also mentioned in the guidelines. And most importantly, establishment of CCTV cameras within police stations has become a must. So the next time you go to a police station, you see, observe whether there are cameras or not. If you feel threatened, immediately make a complaint to the authorities, higher up authorities, that this police station doesn't have cameras, and it is my belief that this area, this police station might be, the police might be abusing their power inside this police station, and therefore it is recommended that CCTV cameras be set up. The police in the state, due to feasibility issues, might not set up cameras in all police stations and all chowkis, but in general, large, most important police stations and police chowkis, it will be set up. Next is the other cases where it is also declared that in the event the procedures are not followed by the police and the police goes beyond their powers, the trial itself might be declared unlawful, and the whole procedure gets vitiated. So the police needs to ensure that they follow the correct procedure, or else it might just let the accused go free because of the abuse of law. Finally, we talk about the sources of law. The essential crux of criminal law comes from the Indian Penal Code, the Criminal Procedural Code, the Police Acts, and the Police Manuals. Besides this, also the Constitution of India and other relevant laws. The other relevant laws include the prevention of sexual offences against children, then Money Laundering Acts, then Foreign Exchange Management Act, Securities Exchange Board of India, offences against companies, stuff like that is contained in various other laws. And these are white collar crimes also. Most of these are white collar crimes. Organized Crime Act. There are multiple state legislations which protect, which Environment Protection Act. So multiple acts which have different punishments and which have specific rules, which as have been mentioned. But the crux are Indian Penal Code, Criminal Procedural Code, Police Act, and Constitution of India. These are the major acts. Finally, a police officer, whenever he is appointed as a police officer, he is made to take an oath. This oath is prescribed by the Department of Personnel and Training. The Department of Personnel and Training has made it mandatory for these oaths to be declared, wherein the person who wants to take office as a police officer needs to state on solemn affirmation that he will abide by the Constitution of India. When he makes such a assurance, what he is virtually doing is he is prescribing to all laws of India, and he is also prescribing to Article 141, which is law declared by the Supreme Court. He declares on oath, he promises that he will ensure that law in India is followed as laid down, and in case he doesn't follow the law, he would be in breach of his oath, which would amount to perjury and is a punishable offence with a punishment of up to 3 years in certain cases. So it is noteworthy that the next time a police officer does something wrong, you could remind him that he is given an oath, and he better remember his oath to follow the Constitution, which means to follow the Criminal Procedural Code and the Indian Penal Code, and if he is violating that, he would be liable to punishment. For such punishment, the competent authority needs to be informed. So does the superiors of that officer need to be informed, so that disciplinary action can be taken against that officer, or mandatory training be issued to that officer. In addition to this, you can also make a private complaint to the magistrate, who will take cognizance and get the competent authorities sanction and accordingly initiate disciplinary action or criminal action against the accused person. Thank you. That's all for this lecture. I hope it was informative and I hope you stay tuned. Please don't forget to subscribe and like this video. Thank you.